graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Fred the Vampire Accountant 7, Out of House and Home, by Drew Hayes. Narrated by Christopher Walker and performed by a full cast.
It just seems a bit much. Standing in the dark of a cool night, I carefully looked over the vehicle, taking in every detail, of which there were quite a few to note. Thick tires jutted out from the sides of a boxy, tremendously oversized cab, topped with a rack of lights, and windows that I'd bet were carrying many more enhancements than a mere spell to mitigate sunlight. But if that seems like a curious feature to assume in a vehicle, perhaps I should pause briefly for a moment to explain. My name is Frederick Frankfurt Fletcher, and my fear of daylight stems from the simple fact that I am a vampire. While I'd gotten around one of our perpetual weaknesses by gaining a silver immunity, the sun was still a force I had to reckon with. With me that evening were Al, a summer fae and recent hire to my accounting company, Gregor, my gargoyle bodyguard appointed by a dragon, Bubba, a therianthrope who worked directly for the head of his local organization, and Lillian, my company's first hire, who'd originally been sent by a rival vampire clan to spy on me. Gathered together in the parking lot of Charlotte Manor, a sentient bed and breakfast who'd been our home now for several years by this point, the crowd still felt a bit thin by our usual standards. It didn't help that so many of our friends were out on assignment, starting with the one whose absence I felt most keenly. While she'd elected to take the name Crystal Fletcher for private use, officially, my wife was still Agent Jenkins, capable and dangerous operative for the agency, a covert organization designed to ensure parahuman laws were properly obeyed. They essentially functioned as enforcers for the countless treaties that governed the various parahuman factions, making sure that things stayed as peaceful as possible and hiding our existence from humanity in general. Her being gone was part of the job, something I'd known and accepted when we took the plunge into marriage. At least she'd been able to take some time off for our honeymoon. Arch, a fellow agent who seemed to be borderline, if not truly, immortal, was also gone on some assignment or other, taking Neil and Albert with him. The necromancer and zombie duo had been getting more attention from the agency since they showed what they could do during the pre-wedding fight. It's a long story, and we're seeing more work because of it. If they hadn't been offered some sort of official position with the organization yet, it was only a matter of time. Also missing was Amy, our resident alchemist, capable of whipping up nearly anything, but who mostly focused on odd concoctions that interested her. She'd been booked to enhance a bar for a local Therian wedding. That left only the House of Fred's newest official member, Asha Patel, a lawyer who'd been a human friend until several months back. Unfortunately, my sire's attempt on my life caught her instead, and it was only thanks to turning her in time, and some very special blood, that Asha was still with us in any sense. Adjusting to vampire life had been going smoothly so far. She was holding up much better than I did after the change, and she seemed to enjoy working nights. Asha would be stopping by when her client meeting ended, but that wouldn't be nearly soon enough to ogle the vehicular monstrosity resting in Charlotte's parking lot. I'd barely made it back myself, having just dropped off some contracts in my ridiculous rental vehicle. Battling with the insurance over my old car being bombed was bad enough, but my in-between options all seemed to be huge, gas-guzzling monsters. As someone who might be on this planet for hundreds of years to come, being eco-conscious seemed the only logical choice. It was a sentiment none of the rental agencies near my town of Winslow, Colorado seemed keen on embracing, but my busy schedule had precluded the time to go car shopping. That was why I'd asked Bubba for help, as the most mechanically inclined person I knew. Standing next to a contraption that appeared as if someone had tried to fuse a tank with an off-road dune buggy, the huge man looked a bit sheepish, even going so far as to rub the back of his neck.
I know what you're gonna say, and before you raise issues, the engine is a custom job. Got some special materials and enchantments in there to increase fuel efficiency by over 50%.
Lillian ran her sharp nails along the front bumper and failed to leave more than a thin line.
That's not the only magic on this thing. I can feel the thrum of power weaving through it. This is a hardy hunk of machinery.
Though I couldn't feel any such magic emanating, I didn't doubt Lillian's assessment. One of the most powerful, terrifying vampirism aspects was our ability to take on the gifts of other parahumans by drinking their blood. It's why the legends of what we can do vary so greatly between years and cultures. Some vampiric abilities are dependent on the blood they've recently been drinking. As someone who stuck only to the human stuff, I was about as weak as a vampire could be. Some slight after-effects of dragon magic notwithstanding. Lillian had a more varied diet, but I trusted her to obtain that stock through legal, ethical means. Apparently, she'd worked some mage blood into her rotation. That would certainly allow her to sense magic so easily. Banging once on the tires, Al then seemed to stroke the air around the vehicle, taking what I could swear was a lick of it at the end.
It's got decent vibes. Not great, but decent.
As a pixie, Al was one of the people whose abilities I understood the least, in no small part because of how rarely she used them. Outside of her magical aura that added haphazard whimsy to the world, Al kept things as professional as possible. From her magically enlarged, human-level size, to her crisp business suit, to the tight braid in her hair, she was a pixie determined to be taken seriously. Given how hard she worked, and the speedy progress on her education, I didn't even mind when my morning coffee occasionally turned into hot chocolate. Gregor knocked his huge knuckles against the hood once, then nodded. For my stoic bodyguard, it was a ringing show of endorsement. No surprise, as it was his job to keep me safe, and this would be a very helpful tool in that endeavor. On a personal level, I still wasn't entirely sure if Gregor actually cared about my well-being. Not that I doubted his effectiveness at the job. Even if Gregor had loathed me to the core, he'd been put in this position by Gideon, our local dragon, king of the West, and apparently something of a folk hero to Gregor's gargoyle clan. I didn't know the entire tale of their history, but it seemed there was little they wouldn't do to earn his approval. Gregor had been told by Gideon to protect me. He'd have to be shattered into rubble before anyone could stop him from fulfilling that order. While everyone else had found something to like, I had to stick firm on my assessment.
Bubba, I appreciate the effort. I really do, but I just don't see this working. It draws too much attention and not the right kind for my line of work. Imagine the terror one of my clients might feel at seeing an assault vehicle pulling up to their drive, or the perils of parking it in a company's lot next to all the normal sedans. The concern for my safety is touching. Maybe we can veer slightly back toward the mundane, though?
Unwise. Your last vehicle was turned into a weapon. You have an enemy you know will use it as a target. Make your transportation secure.
As a rule, I wouldn't go expecting Quinn to repeat himself. He's nothing if not a fan of trying new things.
The name of my sire felt sour in my mouth. Quinn had always been a piece of work, starting with abandoning me after being turned with no explanation or guidance. He'd then kidnapped Crystal before realizing what her profession was. That mistake had cost him an arm, but he still came after me a few years later, armed with a small team of magically controlled vampires. Then there was the bomb planted in my car just before the wedding, a strike that had cost Asha her human life. Deep down, I knew Gregor had a point. Quinn kept coming, and ignoring him wasn't going to make anyone safer. Fighting back might have been a nice fantasy, but even if I had that in me, nobody could find him. Somehow he was staying out of the agency's clutches, along with some powerful fae I suspected were after him as well. Quinn appeared only when he wanted, and there was always some kind of destruction in his wake. Still, I didn't think buying a pseudo-tank was the right solution either. If anything, he'd just view it as a challenge, and I didn't want to see the collateral damage caused by whatever it took to crack this car's shell.
Knew it was a long shot, but Gideon had this sitting around, so I figured we might be able to put it to good use.
Bubba gave me a polite tip of his hat, then started to climb back into the cab. Hang on, you drove all the way out here. Want to stay for dinner? I don't know what Charlotte is making tonight, but I can say with certainty that it will be outstanding. That was putting it lightly. It might be viewed as cheating, since she used magical ingredients in preparation, but Charlotte Manor was an incredible chef. Those lucky enough to live on her premises had meals included as part of the cost. Easily the best money I spent outside of essentials like blood.
Supposed to go pick up Amy from her wedding gig after I run this back, but for Charlotte's supper, oh, I've got time. I'll just swing by in this. Bet Amy will get a hoot out of the ride if she's in a state of mind to notice.
Together, we all headed up the stairs onto the front porch of Charlotte Manor. A sentient home, built by mages many years before, her original creators eventually met their end trying to start a war with the agency. While she could appear within the walls in any form she chose, Charlotte was actually the house itself. A fact we all tried hard not to think about where matters of privacy were concerned. Between her ability to maintain the building, provide food, and the layers upon layers of magical security built into her walls, we were fortunate to have Charlotte as an ally. It was thanks to her that we had a safe place to call home. It was only as I grabbed the front door that I realized something felt off. Usually, Charlotte would have been out on the porch to see the excitement or greet her guests after a long day of solitude. I shook the notion off, dismissing it as paranoia brought on by all the Quinn talk, and pushed open the front door. I was physically knocked back by several inches as I gaped in horror at the sight awaiting us. To describe the scene as simply mad would be a disservice to the chaos awaiting us on the other side of the door. Movement was flurried and fast as multiple versions of Charlotte dashed around, trying to grab the unusual creatures skittering across the walls, floor, and even ceiling. Each one was roughly 3 feet long, with spindly legs poking out of thick, gray shells. The undulating tentacles probing from the mouth were disturbing, but it was the four scythe-like appendages spaced along their bodies that were more concerning. Each bladed bug was cutting into Charlotte Manor, attacking the house around them. I was momentarily bowled over by it all. The shock of being greeted by the unexpected mixed with the confusion of how we hadn't heard anything from the outside. Then there were the questions of why Charlotte was bothering to manifest all these forms to fight back. She had everyone I'd ever seen in the fray, from the old woman who worked the front desk to the sharply dressed waiter who served meals to the young woman in an olden time dress that I thought of as her default. All of them were smacking at the bugs, largely ineffectually. Luckily for Charlotte, I was not the only one in attendance, and several of my colleagues were far more adept at mentally switching gears. By the time I'd recovered myself enough to take action, Bubba and Lillian were already inside, each squaring off against one of the invading insects. Al was weaving some sort of bubblegum-looking substance into existence between her hands, and Gregor was waiting at my side. Assuming he was waiting for me to make the first move, I started forward, only to be halted by a thick hand on my chest.
Too dangerous.
What? I could barely process the words, my brain going a mile a minute as I struggled to understand how the day had suddenly gone so wrong. Gregor tilted his head through the door to where both Lillian and Bubba were having trouble with their opponents. The bugs were quick, and their scythes were evidently unbothered by parahuman toughness. If the giant size hadn't tipped me off that they were supernatural in origin, that certainly would have clinched it. Anything that could hurt those two had to be packing magical augmentation. Much as I would love to claim I charged in with no thought to my own safety, it would be untrue. Looking through that doorway, I was very tempted to let Gregor hold me there. No shortage of excuses rose up in my mind, attempting to balance the value of myself against that of a friend in peril. There was a time, I'm ashamed to say, when cowardice would have surely won out. But I'd seen danger in more amounts than I ever wanted since joining the parahuman world, and I'd learned an important lesson from those experiences. Fear didn't matter more than the people counting on me. I grabbed Gregor's arm and gently moved it aside, both of us aware that he was far stronger. and going in.
An unwise tactic that I cannot condone.
The hand started to move back. Gregor, listen. We've been making great headway these past few months, but I need to make something crystal clear to you. I will not stand by when members of my clan are in trouble and I can help. I understand this makes your job harder, and if you want to quit, then that's totally reasonable. Until then, however, stop trying to control my actions. I'm going in there to help, and I hope you're coming too. There was a sour glare from Gregor, but his hand remained in place.
You make yourself very difficult to protect.
No doubt that's why the King of the West sent me one of his top people, someone capable to the task. It was a bit cheap, invoking Gideon's title and reminding Gregor that he'd been personally appointed to the role. But Bubba nor Lillian had successfully stopped their bug yet. Charlotte didn't just require help. She needed a heavy hitter, which was why I made sure Gregor had the extra touch of motivation. While I can't take credit for what came next, it was deeply gratifying to watch Gregor's oversized fists join the fray, blocking a strike intended for Bubba's leg before spinning around to smash the back half of Lillian's opponent. Whatever protections these blade bugs had, they weren't enough to stand against the fists of a gargoyle. Now that her enemy was slowed, Lillian was able to dart in more easily, her own blades digging into the bits of exposed flesh poking through the cracked shell. As she wore hers down, Gregor and Bubba teamed up on the others nearby. Heavy arms and thick boots combined, transforming the bug from a deadly enemy into a pulpy sludge. The other bugs in view started to scamper, as if they realized the tide of battle had turned. Some got away, but several were trapped in place by a thick, sticky pink goop that had been hurled onto their feet while I was distracted by the battle. Al was only a few steps away, the pink wad still in her hand, firing off an occasional shot toward the skittering scoundrels harassing our home. Between the four of them, they were able to drive off the pests in the foyer and drawing room. Charlotte's default body, the one in the upscale dress, popped into existence next to me, despite the fact that I was watching the same form run down the hallway with broom in hand. It was a flaw in my perception. I still let myself forget that none of them were actually real. She could make a dozen of this form. It was just one more tool for interacting with guests. The real Charlotte was the house around us, the structure under attack.
Fred.
We're here. What happened? Shaking her head, it was clear she was working to focus. Limply, her hand rose, gesturing to a small pile of boxes. Most were unopened, the usual assortment of deliveries that came from living in an online world. One, however, was split completely. Lillian was over in a flash, giving a long smell, then a lick.
Magic. And potent at that. Someone must have laid a hell of an enchantment to pack those things into a space so small. There's more than one mystical scent in here, too.
Ocean.
Charlotte pointed to a small area on the floorboards, where we could just make out the residue of something spilled and a tiny twinkle of glass. Being friends with Amy, I was well versed in the remains left behind when a vial of magical liquid had been shattered.
Binding. Weakening connection.
Whether to prove her point or due to dramatic coincidence, it was at that moment Charlotte's form did something I'd never seen before. It flickered. Like a signal being lost in static, her manifestation wavered and shimmered, growing insubstantial at times before finally stabilizing. At least that explained why Charlotte was so limited in what she could do to fight back. Unfortunately, that revelation only raised more questions and at least one major issue. Until that moment, I'd been under the impression that we were dealing with some sort of pest invasion or simple misunderstanding. The vial of potion removed such possibilities, much as I would have preferred them. A being like Charlotte was far from common, even among the parahuman world. For there to be something in that box specific enough to affect her, this had to be intentional. Someone was targeting Charlotte, making her suffer. Given that she'd been in an abandoned building for decades before joining up with me, our association was the only thing that would make her a tempting target. Anger and shame hit me in equal measure, leaving me as furious at myself for failing to prepare against such a possibility as I was at whoever was behind all of this. There were certainly some choice candidates I could think of, but I tried not to make assumptions. Knowing the true culprit might help us defuse the attack, so I needed to keep my mind open to whatever might reveal itself.
Okay. Situation check. We've got some sort of parahuman bugs infesting Charlotte and hacking up her insides. Plus, she got dosed with something to stop her from fighting them off. That means we need Amy here as fast as possible to whip up a counter. Baba, if you left right now, what's the fastest you could get back?
About an hour. Could be a lot less if she's got the required supplies on hand.
He wiped the heel of his boot on the edge of a carpet already ruined by bug innards. Curiously, these creatures didn't have much in the way of internal organs. They were largely just pulp and blue-green goo. An hour didn't seem like much, unless it was filled with fighting blade-armed invaders. Still, Lillian was right. The best protector of Charlotte was Charlotte. We needed to get her powered back up.
Charlotte, with our help, do you think you can last another hour?
Just as she went to respond, her form flickered again, washing out the words with silence. In the interim, I was surprised to hear Al speak up.
An hour of this should be fine for a construct like her. These things shouldn't even be the threat they are. It's surprising she's hurt by such cosmetic blows. There must be something about those blades designed to make them painful.
Her usually cheerful face crossed, teeth softly chewing on a corner of her lip.
This feels off. Putting together so many magical components would be really expensive. I can't imagine anyone would work that hard just to cause some panic and annoyance.
Neither could I, which was a fact that had me worried. Noticing that Lillian was still hunkered down near the open door, I swung my attention back around. If she'd found any sort of clue or hint, we had to know. Whatever was going on, us being in the dark was not going to help Charlotte.
Sniff something else?
More magic vibes, more lingering odors, just more.
Lillian pointed to the broken glass on the floor.
I gave that a whiff, and there's definitely some of it in here. But that's not all I'm getting. I don't think we've seen all the tricks these things have brought yet.
Given how effective everything they'd brought had been so far, I was terrified to learn what other hidden cards these bugs might have left to play. Were they intelligent? Was this all their doing? It might seem silly, but living in the parahuman world meant taking as little for granted as possible. I shook off the larger questions of who or how and focused on what mattered in the moment. We needed to restore Charlotte's abilities to defend herself, hopefully before our enemies unveiled any new tactics. My mouth was halfway open, the words telling everyone to spread out formed on my tongue when we heard the explosions. Instantly, the form of Charlotte was gone. Down the hallway, just at the tip of the stairs, my eyes caught sight of something moving. It was horrible, yet I couldn't look away. As a vampire, there are very few things that can easily kill us. But one of those elements had just appeared, albeit in an unnatural form. Green flames raced along the barrier, quickly spreading to the nearby wall. The bugs were no longer our largest concern. Not when Charlotte Manor was burning down. When I felt the pressure around my stomach, I feared some unseen element had approached in our distraction, striking while I was unaware. Looking down revealed I'd been mistaken, though the hand trying to push me back did represent a problem. I planted my feet, refusing Gregor's attempt at subtly forcing me to evacuate. He jabbed a finger into my chest.
Vampire.
With the same hand, he flicked a thumb up, gesturing to the green flames already creeping down the hallway.
Fire.
That established, he once more attempted to push me back, only for me to sidestep the attempt. It was something I knew would require dealing with, but at the moment, all of my focus was on Charlotte. Smoke was starting to creep along the ceiling. I could hear the crackle of fire burning deeper within the home, yet there was no manifestation present. She'd already been flickering in and out. Perhaps trying to contain a fire on top of everything else was simply too much. My mind raced, searching for what we could do to help. Given when Charlotte was constructed, She didn't have modern conveniences like integrated fire suppression systems. Considering how potent her control was within these walls, it would have been a redundancy anyway. Except, we'd never considered what could happen if Charlotte lost that control. While my mind floundered to think of an idea, a colleague had already fully formed a plan. Al stepped purposely away from us, kicking off her shoes in the process. With grand, sweeping motions, her arms raked the air until it appeared as if she were swirling some sort of wind together between her hands.
No gum-dropping way am I letting this go down. Not even to Charlotte.
Al, who was now floating off the ground, flung her hands forward, and from them came a torrent of clouds. Soft blue clouds with a rainbow shimmer, but clouds all the same. Due to the nature of Al, whose full name was Alstromeria, there was often a cute, bubbly aesthetic to her magic, which I suspected was part of why she used it so rarely. This was certainly an exception, and one I was grateful for, as the summoned storm began to dump liquid just a touch too pink to be water onto the green flames. The cynic in me knew that it was too easy, so when the flames started to sizzle and shrink without fully vanishing, I was barely even surprised. Someone had mounted an intentional attack on Charlotte Manor. I didn't imagine they'd cheap out on the magical fire.
Sour balls.
Her word choice summed things up nicely. The clouds were buying some time, but at most they were slowing the fire, and only in the sections Al's magic could reach. Given the number of explosions I'd heard, there was more fire than just what we could see, chewing through Charlotte from unknown positions.
Time to go.
Gregor stepped in front of me once more. We are not leaving our friend.
Your friend is burning down. Our only magic wielder just failed. Accept what is lost before the flames take even more.
He's right, Fred. Look at how quick that fire is moving, even fighting the rain. The house is lost.
Terrible as that sounded, I knew Bubba Emerson quite well, and that was not the tone he would use to pronounce death on a member of our makeshift family.
We can't save the walls, but we can save Charlotte. Gotta grab a travel version and then locate the core of Charlotte Manor. In there, you'll find her essence, the thinking center that makes the rest of the place run. If we can get that out, and somewhere with enough ambient magic, she can recover.
Didn't realize you had such an expertise on these matters.
Amy built the travel version while I was around. She likes to talk while she works. I like to listen.
In that moment, I had to make a judgment call. Bubba wasn't our expert in the mystical matters, but he just dangled the only tangible thread of hope our situation had. If we tried this plan, it would put everyone at risk. Well, perhaps not Gregor. I wasn't clear on how gargoyles and fire reacted, but the rest of us were at least somewhat vulnerable to it, if not exceptionally so. Three lives on a gamble that could maybe save one. One didn't need my talent with numbers to see what an awful equation that was. Bubba, do you know where the mini model of Charlotte Manor is?
Last I saw, Amy gave it to Charlotte for safekeeping.
A very sound decision before the attack, and a deeply worrying one in our situation. If it was tucked away in some corner of the house, there was no telling where, or whether or not it was even possible for us to find it. I turned to check the parlor and found a door drifting open. As I looked, it slammed, repeating the process for a third and final time before growing still. Message received. I hoped she could hear my words. It seemed like Charlotte was still with us and trying to help at that. That sealed it. If she was still fighting to survive, then there was no way we were giving up. But as the leader of my clan, I couldn't play a game of trading lives. Facing the others, I put on my best expression of competence, the kind I wore before exceptionally important meetings. Bubba, you go get Amy as fast as possible. We don't know if extra mojo is needed to transport Charlotte, and I'd really rather not find out too late. Al, can you and Lillian make a run to Clover Enchanting and ask for Ainsley or Zane? Tell them Fred sent you. They're some of the most talented enchanters in the country. Maybe they can use something to buy us more time.
Leaving you to deal with the armed insects and fast-moving fire.
Poor decision. Strength of a clan comes from their leader. Protect their safety to protect the greater unit as a whole. Lesser members can be lost, with lower consequences.
As if that weren't enough, he actually stepped in front of me, trying to move me back toward the exit once more.
Gregor, listen to me very carefully. My life is not worth more than that of my friends, and more importantly, it is my life. I wasted my first one on cowardice and isolation. How I live this one is up to me, which means I can risk my safety to save Charlotte if I good and well please.
That is unwise. Your loss represents a greater loss to your clan.
Because I'm your charge?
Because you are their center. All treaties of the clan are connected to you. The Blood Council's diplomacy efforts are tied to you. You are the leader of your people. Your health is theirs. Your strength is theirs. Your loss is theirs.
That point was harder to argue with, especially as I noticed neither Bubba, Lillian, nor Al meeting my eyes. Was this the way most parahumans saw leadership? It was something I would have to delve deeper into when time permitted. I needed to know what my people expected of me to do the job well. But this wasn't the moment for discussing the various philosophies of leadership. Every moment we wasted on debate only shrank our chances of success.
Maybe you're right. This might not be the smart move.
But Charlotte has always been here for us when we needed her. She protected us, fed us, cared for us, and now she's the one who needs help. Charlotte Manor is a member of my clan, and I will not abandon her when there's still hope. I get that it's dangerous and strategically unsound, but the only way I know how to lead is by being there when my people need me. Being my bodyguard means you either have to work with that, or tell Gideon you aren't right for the job.
You would cast me out?
I really don't want to, Gregor. In 10 seconds, I'm going through that door with the hope of saving Charlotte. If you want to come, I welcome the help. If you can't abide my choice or the danger, that's fine. Wait out here. And if you're thinking of stopping me, then please do us both a favor and leave now. I'd prefer to part on pleasant terms. After a long stare, even by his stony standards, Gregor inched his head forward.
I will not fail, my king. I was placed into your service. Therefore, I shall serve.
All in all, our little debate had taken perhaps 2 minutes, and yet in that time, the ceiling was already growing harder to see, and the smoke had continued to build. Worse, I noticed that Al's clouds were thinning, meaning that soon, the fire would be back to full speed.
Everyone, you know what to do. Move like there's fire on your heels, because for one of us, there is.
Order given, I dashed through the door Charlotte had slammed. I made it all of 5 steps before Gregor grabbed my shoulder and yanked me back. An admonishment withered on my tongue as a decorative vase set on an end table nearby was sliced neatly in half. From above, one of the bladed bugs dropped, scythe arms extended to strike as much as possible. The terrifying entrance was cut short as Gregor grabbed hold of the thing's midsection and threw it against a wall. Blue-green goo sprayed up to the ceiling. As the body dropped, Gregor whirled on me.
Do not let haste lessen your judgment. I agreed to follow. Make proper use of my protection.
The remains of a murderous giant insect sliding slowly down the wall were testament to Gregor being correct. I'd gotten so caught up in the fire that the original threat had momentarily slipped my mind. This attack seemed purposely made for harming Charlotte, but there was nothing to stop the rest of us from being collateral damage. Thank you. More important than that, I waited as Gregor looked down the hallway, not moving until he restarted our advance. With Charlotte's timber burning, there was no time for repeated mistakes. We resumed our trek down the hall, soon spotting another door swinging without cause. It led into a spare bedroom, one of Charlotte's unoccupied spaces waiting for a resident. I feared we'd taken a wrong turn until the next door banged, leading us into a shared bathroom that featured another swinging door, this one leading to a new, narrower hall. Curiously, despite having resided in Charlotte Manor for several years, this was an area I'd never encountered before. The tighter corridor forced us to slow down, as a bug ambush could be much more effective when we had such limited room to maneuver. Gregor could probably bash holes in the walls if needed, but at this point, There was no telling how much more damage Charlotte would be able to withstand. If he accidentally broke something load-bearing, we could have several stories of blazing building come down on our head. Creeping slowly along, I noticed something novel along the wall. Pictures. Most were drawings, some clearly from children, others done by skilled adult hands. There was even a rogue photograph, or at least some predecessor to modern photography. Everything in this hall was old. Even the air tasted stale. Had this place always been present, simply sealed off from the rest of us? Occasionally, we would pass by a door, yet none of them so much as wiggled. Each was stock still and silent, forcing us to walk on. The end of the hall loomed in sight. A dead end with an ornate painting hung center on the wall. My eyes were drawn to the art. A portrait of over a dozen people standing in front of a familiar building. We were nearly to it when something else caught my eye. A familiar face smiling at me from the darkness. There, hung along the older drawings and photos, was a picture of Crystal. Peering down, eyes partly amused, huge bite of cake halfway to her grinning mouth. It was a candid photo from a birthday party some years back, and not the only one. Next to it on the left was a picture of Arch and Albert, lost in discussion about some unknown topic. And on the right, Amy and Bubba were captured mixing some strange concoction on the bar. As I scanned, more familiar faces came into view, my own among them. I'd never asked why Charlotte wanted a printer that could spit out quality photographs. When the upgrade happened, I'd taken it to be merely part of her overall modernization, like adding internet and using computers. It hadn't occurred to me, even for a moment, that she might be trying to preserve a piece of us, to hold on to her guests long after they'd gone. But the hall I'd walked down to reach this point told the tale too clearly to miss. A hidden place to remember, perhaps mourn, all those who'd come before. Something to cling to when she was alone once more. With a few more final steps, we reached the large portrait at the end of the hall. Stepping closer, I squinted at the details, muddily rendered as they were. The home was undeniably Charlotte Manor, missing a few design bells and whistles, but her all the same. As for the people in front, they wore simple clothing, mostly dresses and overalls, though several carried staffs with them. Mages, living on the fringes of society, trying to craft a fortress able to withstand any attack. It was futile in the end. They stepped up to someone too strong, and Charlotte was left with empty halls decorated by scraps of memories. It took a few seconds for me to realize that the sound was emanating from behind the painting. Drifting softly backward, the dead-end wall shifted to reveal a set of stairs leading down to a basement. In that moment, I was treated to two sights, each conjuring feelings of similar intensity, yet on opposite sides of the emotional spectrum. My positive sight was sitting on a small table near the bottom of the stairs, Charlotte's travel model. The tiny version of the house was resting in plain view. I'd have it in moments. Unfortunately, I was slightly slowed by the second sight, flames and smoke sizzling atop the ceiling. Wherever this basement was in the manor, the flooring that composed its roof had already caught flame. Searing embers drifted down from overhead, several of them landing near the model of Charlotte. Realizing the danger, my feet were moving before my brain could catch up. Gregor, on the other hand, had evidently already taken a moment to process everything, because he was ready to snag me by the arm as soon as I shifted. With a heavy glare, he stared me down, not bothering to reiterate his earlier point. "We need to move. If that thing catches fire, Charlotte is done."
"Yes. Makes an excellent trap."
With a nod, he tilted his head to a far corner of the ceiling, where I could just make out a hole that had been roughly chopped through the wood. At our angle, there was plenty of the room impossible to see, the sort of areas where deadly invaders could easily lie in wait to spring when an overeager vampire came rushing into view.
"What do we do then?"
Moving both of us back a few inches, Gregor tapped me on the chest.
"Spring it with a stone inside. Be ready to catch."
That was all the warning I got before Gregor went charging for the model of Charlotte, leaping directly off the stairs. I also noted the telltale splat on impact, meaning he'd been right about the trap. Which begged the question, how did these creatures know what we were after? None of them had shown any signs of intelligence, but this felt like one hell of a coincidence to ignore. My contemplation was cut short as Gregor stepped back into view, flinging a blade bug off his back and his now shredded coat. Another bug dove at him, appearing in my field of vision like a face-seeking missile with my bodyguard as its target. Instead of reaching his skull, the bug was met by one of Gregor's fists, a collision that did not end well for the ambitious invader. Momentarily clear, Gregor hurried forward at his top speed, which wasn't especially quick, even by human standards. It was fast enough, though. Gregor reached the model as I saw three more bugs step into my line of sight. I barely had time to wonder how he'd fight with the mini Charlotte in his hands before the wooden structure was airborne. Only then did his warning, "Be ready to catch," snap into place. In life, I was unathletic to the point of near comedy. However, on death has its perks. Thanks to enhanced speed, I was able to get under the model in time, catching it gently in both hands to cushion the fall as much as possible. The moment it hit my palms, a flash of light caught my eye. At the far left of the basement, glowing lines were weaving along the stone wall, forming an archway of arcane symbols. Since I'd yet to see the bugs cast a spell, odds were strong it was more help from Charlotte. Getting her traveling body was only part of it. The case to carry around her essence, exactly the sort of thing that would most likely be behind a magical door in a hidden basement. While I was tempted to go rushing off, Gregor's most recent lesson was fresh in my mind, especially since he was still dealing with the last of the bug trio that had attacked him. Horrible as it felt to stand there, watching the ceiling overhead burn, I waited as he wrapped up the fight, finally catching the last bug underfoot and crushing it down the midsection. Gregor looked over, and I thought I saw a flicker of surprise in those stalwart eyes as he noted me still waiting per instructions. Giving me a wave, Gregor started for the glowing archway. While I was significantly faster, he did have quite the head start. That was why, when the beam came down, I was out of range. A huge, flaming beam of wood came crashing down. For a terrible moment, they were both there, frozen in my vision. Gregor, eyes half raised in surprise, and the huge, fiery beam plummeting down. Then my eyes were shut, on reflex more than anything. Surly as he could be, I counted Gregor as at least an ally, if not a friend. No part of me wanted to see him crushed by kindling. When I forced my lids apart, however, that was not the sight awaiting me. Somehow, Gregor had gotten his arms up in time and had caught hold of the beam, hands gripped into the burning wood as he held the monstrosity high overhead. Of course, much more than just the beam was coming down now. Much of the structure it had supported was tumbling onto the heap. I waited for Gregor to toss his burden aside, only to realize that he wasn't moving. A quick scan of the area told me why. With the ceiling partially collapsed, flaming debris was drifting down all over that area. Our only clear path left to the archway was the one Gregor was manually holding in place. Snapping to the realization, I hurried over, half expecting him to stop me as I hunkered down to crawl under the immensely heavy burden suspended in his arms. Looking him over, Gregor didn't seem to be either in pain or discomfort. Not that I had much faith in him to show it, if such were the case. I wasted no time, hurrying through to the other side so his task could be done. Once through, I popped up, ready to help however he needed to set the beam down. Instead, I was treated to a stiff shake of the head.
You'll need to get back out. Have to keep the exit open.
Already, I could see the fire working its way down his arms, searing away his clothes to reveal the skin beneath. While some of it was the same shade as Gregor's face, other patches were a dark gray, expanding its territory before my eyes.
Can you do that? Safely, I mean.
I am of the Slate Claw Clan, on a task handed down by the Great King himself. I would never shame my clan by dying with a job unfinished.
Standing around debating wouldn't help anyone. There was nothing else to do. Gregor said he could handle it, so my only choice was to trust him. Not just for his own sake, but for mine and Charlotte's as well. touching a hand to the stone between the glowing archway, I watched as the rock crumbled away to dust, revealing what seemed to be total darkness waiting beyond. That was especially disconcerting, as someone who could usually see despite a lack of light. I needed no extra encouragement, however, as the heat on my back was already plenty of motivation. Holding the model of Charlotte Manor close, I stepped forward, plunging into the darkness. Whatever mystical barrier the shadow represented, it felt akin to walking through a patch of cold air on a hot summer's day, or as close to that sensation as I could recall. After just a few years sans sunlight, those memories were growing fuzzy. I imagined that for the longer-lived vampires, such recollections had long been lost entirely. It took only a second to cross through, but when I made it to the other side, my feet came to a sudden halt. This place absolutely thrummed with magic. I could feel it in my teeth like strong bass from an overpowered speaker. Arcane symbols were drawn in spirals all around the walls, connecting and joining together into one nexus point at the center. From that point jutted a giant crystal, also covered in arcane etchings. Light moved through the depths of crystal like a shimmering ocean, intensity rising and falling, sending out a wave of illumination that raced through the arcane spirals before joining with the very material of the walls. I just found the source of the pulse. Now, I had to figure out what part of all this was Charlotte's essence.
I can't believe you made it down here.
Spinning around, I found myself facing Charlotte, the form of her in an overly elaborate dress, the one I thought of as her default. It was curious, matching my mental image of Charlotte while standing next to what could be considered her true form. Cognitive dissonance could wait, though. There were more important matters to deal with. It wasn't my easiest trip around the house.
Sorry. Turning off my defenses is never easy by design, and right now I'm putting all the energy I can get out into keeping my walls standing. Even that is failing. I'm losing my connection to the house as it burns. Normal fire is bad enough, and this stuff is augmented. Between the potion weakening me, then fighting the bugs, and now suppressing the fire, I'm pretty drained.
Then let's not waste our opportunity. Lifting the travel box, I jiggled it around as if she couldn't see. Al said you could survive in here.
For a short time. The magics that make me are complex. I'd need something much more powerful and fortified to be stable.
Her eyes lingered on the giant crystal, which I presumed to be her current home.
Let's get you out, and then find a suitable replacement. Our clan has Amy. I have a strong relationship with two of the most talented enchanters of their generation. And if push comes to shove, there are entities I can ask a favor from. We'll find a way to keep you safe.
I believe you, Fred. I believe you'd find a way, though it wouldn't be worth the cost. I don't know.
Her form curled in slightly, and I realized that for all that we'd been through, this was the first time since we'd met that I'd seen Charlotte afraid.
I'm an old house, set in her ways. I don't know what it would be like to have another form. This place is me. My body. The idea of being jammed into a new one? Of not really being me anymore. I'm not sure it's worth all the trouble I'd cause you.
Charlotte, that is absolute...
My words were cut off, along with the significant section of my right calf, as something suddenly sliced me from behind. Tripping forward, I twisted to find myself staring at one of the blade bugs, dark blood clinging to its foremost scythe. Except, as I looked it over, I realized this wasn't just one of the bugs. This one was different. It had its own arcane symbols painted on the stomach and shell, along with a few on the legs. More eye-catching was the gleaming red gem stuck directly in the center of its forehead. Yet all of that paled in comparison to what came out of its mouth.
Oh, Fred. I'll never stop enjoying that look of shocked terror in your eyes until I eventually cut them out.
The voice of my sire, Quinn. Dozens of questions crammed into my mouth like passengers on an overcrowded subway, but most never made it to the tongue. While I couldn't figure out all the details of how this was possible, some of them were easy to deduce. Quinn had a background in magic,
Even if he couldn't cast, I'd seen him use enchanted objects multiple times, so getting his hands on augmented fire wasn't much of a stretch. Presumably the gem was either some sort of control mechanism, or he'd transformed himself into one of these creatures. My gut heavily favored the first option. Quinn was never one to take a needless risk, especially when he had pawns at hand. There were other issues I didn't understand, like what these creatures were or how he'd known to coordinate an attack, but these were largely logistical. In the end, the ambitious question that finally forced its way to freedom had nothing to do with the how of it all.
Why are you attacking Charlotte?
Why am I tearing down the magical fortress that makes you so difficult to read?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.